From mind to metal, it's Randy Grubb's Garage.
Don Tippett and I developed the overlapping panel construction method as an efficient way to build the DecoLiner, which is built on a 1973 GMC motorhome chassis that has a front wheel drive setup with torsion bars in the front and rear swing arms acting on airbags in the rear. This allows a very low frame height, which we were trying to maintain so that we could stack the flying bridge on top with its driving station. We wanted it to look like it was something built and designed in the 1940s. I chose an early 1940s white Model 3000 COE cab for its beautiful Art Deco lines. They're so flowing, and it really captured the Flash Gordon-esque feel that I was going for. Although most GMC motorhomes weigh in at between 10 to 12,000 pounds, the DecoLiner came in at only 7,500. So it runs down the road just fine. That big 455 Olds doesn't get great mileage, but it's more about the smiles per gallon than the miles per gallon when you're driving the DecoLiner. I ended up with just over 5,000 man hours in the DecoLiner over an 18-month period. I know that doesn't compute because it's 7 days a week and a whole lot of hours from every day from myself and even some friends that helped me. But the response we got, even at the early shows when it wasn't even done, really proved we were on the right track.
Everybody that sees it is instantly like curious, first of all. It's such an odd thing. And then it brings them back to a time in their life when you were a kid and you watched cartoons or something like that. It's a thrilling kind of a feeling. And it's amazing to watch people that gravitate to it. You can have 50, 70, 80 cars around that are beautiful cars, but it seems like they all end up here.
July 2013, I got an offer on the DecoLiner that I just couldn't refuse. So before we turned over the keys to the new owner, my friends and I took it for a final shakedown voyage up Grants Grove in Sequoia National Park in California. It passed the test climbing those steep mountain roads with flying colors, and once we got to the park, man, the international tourists really got a kick out of it. The airplane feel of the interior kind of developed over time. It started with 3/4-inch water knife cut ribs, and these oval holes are actually the bucking hole that we get to the back of the rivet from. So that hole became a design element that we really played up. man, talk about nature's power. I mean, man, here we are at Grants Grove in Sequoia National Park in California, and look at the size of these trees. They are really something, I mean, nowhere else in the world. And what better way to take it all in but from the flying bridge of the DecoLiner. I mean, wow, talk about a lucky, lucky guy to be able to be cruising around on the flying bridge of the DecoLiner with his buddies, taking in Grants Grove. Woohoo! We have a bunch of German tourists, and I'm trying to tell them it's German, but they're not biting on it. Here we are in Kings Canyon at Grants Grove, checking out the old sequoias and the giant redwoods. Man, this is cool.
Every creation Randy does is unbelievable. Always outside the box, comes up with these amazing creations. He's the foremost artist, automotive artist in the world right now. It's like being with Picasso or Rembrandt.
Believe it or not, with over 15,000 miles on the DecoLiner, we've never even been once stopped by the police. But this park ranger obviously had a little more curiosity than most. When you're designing for the future, it's about studying the past. I think that the success of the DecoPods with their overlapping panels, it's just a reinterpretation of the overlapping design that you see on these early bumper cars. It's all about studying the past so that we can go forward into the future.
The idea for the DecoPod struck Randy when he was sitting on the buck of the fender of his B702 one day. It made him think of one of his favorite bikes of all time, Orly Ray Courtney's streamlined 1930 Henderson. Then he and Don Tibbett started working up concept drawings for a series of motorcycles shaped like tapered silver bullets.
This is basically a hand-formed aluminum body over a Honda 85. Interesting thing, because it has doors on a motor scooter, which is kind of an interesting concept. And then again, the handlebars and everything are underneath the cowl. So
the first DecoPod was welded together from three sheets of metal. It sports two doors, a 39 Ford headlight, Triumph TR3A trunk lid hinges, and Peterbilt cab running lights for turn signals. The second DecoPod, the Model B, was the first to use rivet lines and panel seams as design elements. It has two headlights, a custom cast taillight, and is built on a Piaggio motor scooter.
All right, so here it is. This is the third DecoPod in the series, and of course we changed it up radically once again, so it gets another designation. It's a Model C. Why a Model C? Well, because it's only a one-door model. It only has one door on this side. Why did we do one door? Well, there's a couple reasons. Structurally, it's a lot stronger with one door, but most importantly, we're playing now with this rivet line. This panel, it's a lapped panel construction. We've got one panel lapping over the other with this rivet line connecting one panel to the next. And we're really playing with this
line and the rivet line that they create. The flow of those lines are what this piece is all about. So the door, the side that has no door, has none of the vertical lines interrupting the beautiful flow of the panels. That's why we did it as a one door. Now, of course, this one also is just a one light model. It just has a single headlight as opposed to the B model, which has two headlights and two doors. So we keep changing it up. We keep making each one an individual piece of art. This one has the polished bump rail, which is a lot of fun also. So at this point, we're just now ready to start thinking about fitting this onto the chassis. The body itself weighs between 30 and 40 pounds. It's all done, and it's an integrated shell. And now we're just ready to fit it onto the chassis. What kind of chassis is underneath these things, you may be wondering? Well, here's your answer. It's right over here. We use a Vespa motor scooter. It's actually a Piaggio, the parent company to Vespa. They've been making motor scooters since the 1950 something or others. They're the Italian company, the best motor scooters you can buy. So what we do is we start with a Piaggio Fly. This is 150cc. It goes a little over 60 miles an hour. It's a great bike. And they're really nicely the way they're set up. They've got this big well here to put your helmet in, and that becomes the seat well. So what we do is we start with a brand new Piaggio Fly and strip all of the plastic off of it and mount our DecoPod shell on the top of it. Now, what does a stripped down Piaggio Fly look like? Well, come over here and I'll show you. It looks about like this, guys. Why did I choose the Piaggio Fly? Well, because of the center tube backbone. It's really narrow. You got to put your feet down in the DecoPod, and you got to put your feet on each side of this center frame. That's why the Piaggio works really, really well. And basically all we've done is cut the seat box down a little bit. I took the handlebars off, turned them upside down to create a lower seating position and a lower handlebar position. But as you can see, I still am ergonomically very nice seated position. So now this is our stripped down chassis that the DecoPod body goes on. So that's the next step. Let's see how this body fits on it. Okay, we just nestle it down. How's it looking, Don?
Looks really good from this end.
All right, and if it hadn't been for Don Tippett on design, boy, he helped me get all these flowing lines lined up just perfect. Thank you, Don. So you can see our shell now, DecoPod shell, is fitting over the original Piaggio chassis. It fits really nicely. Now all I do is fabricate five mounts to bolt this sucker down, and heck, the next thing you're gonna see is me driving this thing down the road.
My normal DecoPods are built on a Piaggio Fly 150 chassis, and that works really good. This is one of the MP3 Piaggio chassis, one of those ones with the cool dual front wheels. The whole thing leans and turns. It's super trick, or really a sophisticated piece of engineering. What I don't like about this particular chassis, now that I've got all the plastic stripped off of it, is the fact that it's got these dual frame rails that are set very, very wide and the gas tank in between it. This isn't optimum for you for making into a DecoPod, because you're going to have to step over the gas tank, and it's a little wider than I'd like. It's still going to work fine though, but we're going to have to modify the back of these frame rails. It's too wide. So next time you see this chassis, we're going to have some rather significant modifications made to it.
A wooden buck is made to give symmetry to the final form. Patterns are first made of paper, then in wood, before the final aluminum panels are cut, shaped, and polished.
Got all of our panels shaped and they're sitting on our buck. They're still floating though. Now it's time to drill a hole and cleco it. That'll lock everything down.
Okay, now we're buffing. Nothing funner than buffing. Get all black, track stuff in the house, wife yells at you, it's great.
Okay, so now let's see how the rest of these panels fit. We're ready to cleco them all onto the buck. Start with the back. Okay, so now you can see where the wooden buck is. The wooden buck is still underneath. It's giving me my shape. Now the next step is to actually pull all these plecos out and start riveting it together for real without the wooden buck underneath.
Cleco comes from the aircraft industry, and it's a temporary rivet. It's a way to put panels together over and over again without committing to the final rivet.
Okay, the MP3 DecoPod is an air-cooled bike. That means it needs a radiator. That means it needs a grill. We're making these really cool grills for them. They're all a little bit different. We start by cutting them out of 3/16 plate aluminum with a water jet, and then we start shaping them. How do we shape it? Well, we start by running it through the slip rolls and giving it a single plane curve, which matches our buck. All right, here we go. Single plane curve that matches our buck. Now we head over to the power hammer to give it the curve this way.
Randy took his first tripod to the 5th Annual Quail Motorcycle Gathering in Carmel, California, where it won the coveted Innovation Award.
Yeah, great. So, this is definitely innovative.
Hi, I'm Dave Johnston. I'm the proud owner of the first Deco tripod. And I love this guy. Everywhere I take it, it gathers a crowd, and that's primarily because it's not a toy, it's a piece of art. It's a Randy Grubb original. The guy thinks outside of the box, he builds these beautiful pieces, and it's just a neat, neat piece. And it's one of the few motorcycles that has doors. It makes it nice to get in and out, and I just love it.
At the 12th Annual Car Classic Show at the Art Center College of Design in Pasadena, Randy was a panelist alongside Freeman Thomas, the creator of the new Beetle concept car.
Hey, look at that, right underneath the Beatles. Jay Leno makes the Daily Courier.
Just before his retirement from The Tonight Show, Jay Leno hosted Randy and his DecoPods on his program, Jay Leno's Garage.
DecoPod number 4, Bipod number 4. We're doing bipods and tripods, and I'm going to do 6 of each. So we're over halfway through the whole edition. Now what a long, strange trip it's been. The DecoPods have come a long way. From the first one that I did that was basically welded together out of 3 pieces of metal, and it was all planished, and it looked like one piece, to Don and I developing this lap panel construction, which I really, really like, to this is the first one to get the copper. And I really enjoyed working with the copper, and I think it really adds a lot.
Okay, I'm fitting the lights to the DecoPod. It may be a simple thing, but actually from a metal shaping standpoint, turning this edge and making this headlight bucket is actually one of the hardest pieces of metal to shape on this whole thing. But we got one in here and it's looking pretty good. And while I've been doing this, Don has been working on a very cool piece of metal. We're gonna put a copper lightning bolt down the side of it. We'll be right back.
panel construction has been a lot of fun to develop with my friend Don Tippett. And where will it ultimately end up? Well, it's hard to say. We're designing a car right now that'll actually have this same lap panel and riveted construction technique. It should be very interesting. I don't know any vehicles that are built this way. So it's an exciting turn, and the DecoPods have led me to this point along the path, and I think it's pretty fun. So I think a car.
Related to the DecoPods, the Decoson is a unique vehicle built on a 1984 Harley-Davidson Sportster chassis.
We're starting another new project. You remember the DecoPods? You fit in them and there was a little Piaggio Fly motor scooter underneath them? Well, this is completely different. The whole concept started when I was sitting on a fender for my B702 one day. We're kind of back to that. We're sitting on the outside of the shape this time. And what's underneath our shape? Well, it's right down here. A lot more power, a lot more speed, a lot more rum rum. It's gonna be fun. All right, so here's the basic concept, guys. This is the basic buck. This fits over our Harley-Davidson Sportster. Here's our Sportster, and we're gonna strip it down. What we're gonna do is strip all the stuff off that we don't need, like the speedometer, we don't need, handlebars, we don't need. We'll be dropping them down using some dragster style. So this is where it all starts, guys, getting the basic shape. These are the mechanics that we can't move. We can't move the motor. We can't move the forks or the rear end. So as you can see, I've now created this outside shape that just captures my headstock and allow my clip-ons to fit underneath there. So I'll be able to steer it and ride it. We'll put some big holes to reach through, to reach those. But then the shape will come down. It'll drop down lower than this for a lower seating position. And then here's about where our rear fender will be. So this is kind of where it all starts. And here's the full buck that's developed from these really basic shapes. This full buck actually fits over the top of our Sportster. And yeah, we're actually going to be riding it about like this. So next time you visit me, we're going to be pounding out metal to fit this thing. It's fitting pretty good. You know, I got a lot of contour in this panel. Okay, I'm really pleased how the lines came out on this thing, and we just punched it full of louvers. We went over to Mr. Bill's shop and borrowed his louver press, and thank you, Mr. Bill. It really came out cool. These things, and the coolest thing about them is they're innies, not outies. That's right, we punched the louver in rather than punching it out so that we still have a really smooth exterior skin. Next time you see me, hopefully I won't have a Clico up mine. Yeah. Okay, I really like the way the panels and the rivets play together. The rivet line and the panel line itself, they really complement each other. Okay, we're finally getting there. We're onto the last panel and it's looking good. All right, now's the moment of truth. Our 84 Sportster has been fully modified. From the Avon Speedmaster front tire, our moon disc in 19 1/4 inch, moving on back to our cool clip-on style dragster style front steering. We moved the original Harley switches to a lower location, cut the peanut tank in half, holds a little less, but it's still gonna work great. We cut the frame off, we got rid of the shocks and everything. Now it's rigid, so now's the moment of truth. Is it all gonna work?
Sounding like a Harley-Davidson Sportster, but looking like a futuristic fantasy with a mirrored skin, The Decoson made its first appearance in the historic downtown district of Grants Pass, Oregon.
You're the first bike guy to sit on. Now, what do you think?
Feels like a drag bike.
Bikes flow through your veins, not through mine. I am not familiar with every bike that Arlen Ness and all these great, great builders, and there's lots of them, have built.
Yes, there is.
Now, in your mind, is this a breath of fresh air, or is this based on any design that you've ever seen?
It's not based on anything I've ever seen. The fabrication is unbelievable, and it's the fabrication that makes the bike. You've just gone beyond anything that anybody's done.
For the last 15 years or so, I've been working on automobiles, designing and building my own cars from scratch, hammering out the bodies from scratch in my own little backyard shop right here in Grants Pass, Oregon. There you go. Well, now that's a stretch. I had to add a little oil bag, and you see my batteries now up here.
Yeah, I don't see that.
I do, Randy Grubb. And the Deco Davidson, or the Decoson, is just the latest piece in a long line of crazy, crazy sculptures that you actually get to ride.
Riverside Park in Grants Pass is the perfect setting for one of the most beautiful motorcycles in the world. The park is on the bank of the historic Rogue River next to the landmark Caveman Bridge. For its world debut, Randy trailered the Decoson behind the DecoLiner down to Carmel, California for the 5th annual Quail Motorcycle Gathering. Quail is the premier motorcycle show on the West Coast, a true feast for collectors, riders, builders, and designers. Randy took second in the custom modified category for the Decoson, along with the Innovation Award for his first tripod.
None other than Randy Grubb, who's come here from Oregon, also known as Captain Fantastic or something along those lines. Randy, this is crazy. I think you'd all agree. Congratulations, Randy.
All right, it didn't take me long when I was cruising around one of my DecoPods to figure out I needed to be properly accessorized. And what better accessory do you need than a super streamlined Flash Gordon-esque helmet? So that's where the Deco helmet came from. And it's a really neat project that kind of shows you everything that I do, but it's a small project and won't take years to complete. So let me run you through how we build a really cool helmet.
Okay, from the mind to metal. What does it take to make a flat sheet of metal into something like this? Well, we start with a lot of shrinking, and we're going to do it right now. Okay, that was 6 little shrinks, and look already, it's starting to take shape, you guys. It's not flat anymore. Okay, this is a Marchant 12A. It's a pneumatic shrinker with a 12-inch throat. It's a really great shrinker. It's got a very light touch. As I work alloy and I polish my panels. So it's about getting out these teeth marks. Okay, we're getting a lot of shrinking done, as you can see. This is the panel that we're trying to make, and we started with a flat sheet just a few minutes ago. And after some shrinking around the outside of it, boy, it's looking good already. Okay, remember there's only really 5 things you can do to the piece of metal, right? You can cut it, you can join it, you can bend it, you can stretch it, or shrink it. And in what we're doing here, it's mainly concerned with the stretch and shrink and the bend. So what I've done is started with the shrinking. We do a lot of shrinking around the perimeter of the piece, and look how it's cupped it around, and already it's got a great form. Now we head over to the power hammer and blow out the center of it,
and we're on our way to making a really cool part. So what we're doing is raising with the power hammer right now. The Bailey works great for it. So the name of the game is try to keep the panel as square as you can with the dies so that the hammer meets squarely. When the panel is not jumping, that shows you that your panel is in perfect alignment. When it starts to that's when you're not doing a darn thing but bending your panel and ruining it. So the name of the game is to try to relax, not fight the machine. Just a few minutes ago, this was our flat sheet of metal. We shrunk the edges, we blew out the inside of it, and look at this, we're ready to planish already. To planish. It's a French word, to make smooth by hammering. Let's hammer. That was just a bend through this area. Man, did it change it. We actually get to use the helmet as a buck. So we're trying the parts on it and seeing how they fit. Okay, as you know, my panels are polished, so we got to get rid of these shrinker marks. And what kind of a whiz bang tool do we use? Oh yeah, it's totally automatic. We hand it over to our magic shrinker mark remover. Okay, so now the name of the game is to start getting this thick sucker centered up on the helmet. So Don, I got the front in the right spot. How's it look from the back?
Looks pretty close.
Okay.
Looks pretty close.
Now we're going to make a couple marks here just to indicate where we are so it goes back in the same spot every time. That's really important. Okay, a good sharp file really does wonders. It shows me my highs and my lows and it removes material remarkably fast. Hand tools are great. Let's not forget about the value of a good, sharp hand tool. The first hole is going to lock it down, baby. So that first hole is the all-important hole. Okay, we just bead rolled it. These nice little steps in the edge. Yeah, looks cool.
polish first before you rivet. It makes it a lot easier. Okay, at this point, the panels have been shaped, they've been fitted, they've been clecoed together, they've been taken back apart, the panels have been sanded and polished, and now they're ready to cleco back together. And once we get them all clecoed together, we'll pull one cleco at a time and rivet that sucker up. Okay, I'm using a body dolly as a bucking bar, and it's really important that you hold the bucking bar really squarely to the rivet, or the rivet will not mash down uniformly and squarely.
As a boy, Bob Maddox was introduced to rockets by the Roadrunner show. He loved seeing Wile E. Coyote strap himself to a rocket and light the fuse. In the 90s, he built his own personal jetpack to go skydiving with, followed by jet-powered go-karts, bicycles, drag bikes, and hot rods. The Rocket Man has even built jet skateboards. In 2013, Maddox teamed up with his friend Randy Grubb to build the Pulse Jet Lakester.
Every now and again we get a project that falls into the totally crazy category. This would be one of them, Bob Maddox Pulse Jet Lakester. With 1,000 pounds of thrust, this baby's gonna fly. Of course, the Germans were the ones that originally developed the Pulse Jet, but what a lot of people don't know is Ford developed it too. That's right, under the Loon program in 1944 in the Willow Run Bomb Assembly Plant, Ford actually developed these motors and ran them. So this is the unknown Ford project. We call it the Lunatic. Okay, Chinese fire drill.
Oh, take the steering wheel off. Don't hit the red button. Whatever you do. That was close, Bob. I almost hit the red button.
Oh, man. Let me get out here and throw this thing.
Got it. All right.
not for the guy it's built for.
Now he looks much better in there, doesn't he?
And so we're inside the car right now, so let's look at see what we've got. We've got our butterfly steering wheel, which comes off so we can get in and out. This is a very tight fit in here. Then we have our brake. It's over here. It has a master cylinder right between my legs. So we've got the brake right here. Well, let's look in the controls of this bad boy. We've got our main switch here that turns on everything. We've got our spark and air. Our air is 130 PSI. Our spark is 7.4 million. Then this switch is the main switch. So we throw that, starts our main injectors that fires the engine. It goes to about 500 pounds of thrust. We flick this switch. Starts up the second injectors. We have a volume control down here that controls the amount of fuel that we put into the second injectors and takes us up to full throttle. These aluminum intakes that look just like a jet fighter intake, it's exactly what they are. We're pulling air in off of the surface of the front of the car. It's coming in, feeding our intake of the jet engine, so we've got plenty of air into the engine. Then the rest of the engine bypasses, the rest of the air bypasses down, comes around the engine, pulls all the heat off of the engine so we don't overheat our engine, flows down the car and off the back.
This pulse jet engine runs on an atomized gas-air mixture that is continuously injected under pressure into the combustion chamber. The mix explodes in the chamber, which closes the one-way revalve in the nose and creates thrust when the gases rush out of the end. After each explosion, a negative pressure is created in the chamber that opens up the one-way valve and sucks in fresh fuel and air. It also pulls fire back up the tailpipe, repeatedly touching off the fresh fuel mixes in a regular pulse.
Our chassis is an inch and a half steel tubing that runs all through the car, all the way to the back. We have drop axles, front and rear. Actually has front axles, front and rear on it because the front steers and the rear doesn't, but we just locked them out. On the front and rear, we have Goodyear Eagle tires. They're rated to 500 miles an hour. These tires actually are what you would normally see on the front of top fuel dragsters. So we should be good as far as taking the speed that we can put on them. We did our first test run over at the dry lake bed at Cedarville with Ray Rosa and his crew last year. Had a lot of fun. Had a few issues. We had a tank that wasn't venting correctly, so it didn't run as long as we wanted to, but we're getting her all put back together this year, and we're going to go over and put down some good times this year.
Pin-up model Kristen Barker was photographed with the Lakester at the Red Barn at Gold Hill, Oregon for a magazine article. She gave a high-octane performance with the car and its monstrous exhaust. Maddox test-fired the Lakester in 2013 at the dry lake bed at Cedarville, California, where Paul Cuffney, Rat Rod Ray, and the West Merlin crew backed him up. Cuffney has his own plans to break 200 miles an hour at Bonneville at the wheel of his 36 Plymouth sedan.
Okay, how fast, when, and where are we going to run this thing? Well, SCTA doesn't recognize thrust, so you won't see it as Bonneville during speed week, unfortunately. But how fast will it go? Well, this motor puts out 30% more power than the original V1s. The original V1 was a 4,500-pound rocket with a 2,500-pound warhead that flew at 450 miles an hour. Our motor puts out more power and is in a drop-tank Lakester that doesn't weigh 1,000 pounds. So you do the math on that one. It should idle to over 200 easily. Stay tuned, and Bob is going to be the one that presses the full throttle button. Wow. Oh, fire!
My buddy Tim Cotterill is this world-famous artist from Leicester, England. He goes by the moniker of Frogman. Why? Because he makes these beautiful bronze frogs. He's world-famous for these suckers. So when it came time for him to have his new Rocket 3 built, he contacted me.
First, the Frogman built the Rocket 1, a trike he made famous in England. Next came the muscular 1,000-horsepower blown Hemi Rocket 2. This monster does 0 to 100 in less than 5 seconds, with a top end of about 200. Then he designed a powerful, ultra-sleek machine, the Rocket 3, that would combine his love of choppers, trikes, hot rods, and dragsters.
All right, we've got the Frogman project laid out. It's really very super cool. Let's start at the very front. Up front, we've got a Kugel independent Indy style push rod front end. Super cool, all polished stainless steel. It's about as good as you get. The motor, we're using a Chevy Eco Rod motor. This is a brand new thing offered by Chevrolet to be completely smog compliant when we're done, even in the state of California. Pretty tall order. In back of it, we've got a 480LE overdrive transmission. Super cool piece. And the best part is in the back. Come on back, let me show you how this works. Okay, the heart of the rear end on this sculpture, Rocket 3, is the super cool rear end. What it is the center section of a Kugel independent rear end that's got the inboard disc brakes on it, and we specially modified the hubs so we could bolt these massive 20 by 20 inch rims directly to it. That makes the narrowest rear end imaginable. Now, the whole rear end is going to move up and down as a single unit. The chassis is going to come back, and we're going to have a big pivot and allow the whole rear end to move up and down, pivoting on that giant swing arm. There's Tim's idea of what the swing arm is going to look like. Once we get the template figured out, we'll cut these plates out of 1¼-inch solid aluminum. Should make a great, great swing arm.
The swing arms were cut out of aluminum plates by computer-controlled water jets. Then, the beautiful radiuses on the swing arms were milled by CNC.
Okay, Rocket 2 showcased the beautiful blown Hemi engine. Rocket 3, this quad, you're not even going to see the engine. It's going to be super streamlined, all high polished aluminum. Aerodynamic, super slick, it's going to cut the air. This machine will be a fantastic freeway flyer.
Okay, you saw us cut these beautiful swing arms. Attaching them to the frame was the next step with the bearing, and now it's a matter of suspending the whole thing with some sort of spring. I came up with this quarter elliptical design. It's totally unique. No one's ever done anything like this to my knowledge. And not only is it functional, but it's aesthetically beautiful. Notice how the arc of the spring is following the arc of the swing arm. So now it's a matter of figuring out, do we have enough spring rate? So you got to figure that we're going to be adding at least another couple hundred pounds to this thing, which is about what I weigh.
This is great. We know what we're going to do here. This line is getting really close now. We're getting very close to the line.
So on the transmission, that back point.
this is the feel I'm going to get with this thing. I always loved those big old auto union cars from the 30s. Monstrous engine, tire spinning, tire smoking, polished aluminum, big swells at the side for fuel tanks, lots of noise, lots of smoke, very dangerous. It's going to be fantastic.
Okay, now we're starting with solid stainless steel to build that exhaust system that Tim wants. As you see, the body line comes down here, and these will just bulge outside that body line just a little bit, creating what he describes as a manly bulge. The buck is something that you build to show you the shape in three dimensions. It's a shaping tool. It allows you to see and shape to the buck. This particular buck is a wire buck. It's made out of 1/4-inch steel rod. The steel rod bends in a very nice, you can make very nice smooth curves, one piece at a time. You develop the shape that you're looking for. It's a very organic, natural way to build a buck. Okay, we've been having some fun shaping some metal.
Okay, at this point in the game, it's about getting the balance of the sculpture just right. As you can tell, we've got the skin pretty well shaped up, and you can really see what this sucker is looking like. It's really got this kind of insect, kind of anthropomorphic, where the human fits into it over here. It's really got some very interesting design qualities about it. The things that have really made this piece good in my mind are these reverses. They're incredibly difficult to make, but I think they've really helped balance the sculpture. They've helped diminish the volume as we get toward the back.
The exhausts are all inside here, they get very hot, so we've got these beautiful sculptural vents to get rid of all the heat. All this beautifully sculptured aluminium, you can see how I actually fit into the machine. It's very organic, very something like you'd find coming out of the ocean. It's beautiful.
Okay, so Frog's final assignment today is design the handlebars, the crowning touch for this thing, and once again they're going to be like no other handlebars you've ever seen.
This is how I want them, about this wide, but not in tube.
But very sculptural.
Sculptural, so they're going to be cut out of sheets of 1/8 aluminium, stacked together with a 1/4-inch spacing, so that it will resemble a squished up version of this sculptural area here.
So it's about unifying all the designs together and making all these elements kind of mimic and play off of one another. And I think this will really do it for us, Tim.
Yes. We'll be right back.
4,000. That's
see,
great.
It shifted. You see it shift that, there? It went shift, down to 38.
Yeah.
Now we're
water
up 6 grand.
Oil pressure 31. Perfect.
Yeah, we're now at 198 miles an hour. It just went over 200. We're in the 200 mile an hour club.
I can't believe it. This is awesome. Underneath the handlebar on the left side here, there's four buttons, hidden buttons. The inside one is the left turn, the middle one's the horn, the right turn, and then the high beam, low beam. So those buttons replace all the dashboard buttons. We don't need anything else. On this side is the throttle. It's a twist grip throttle, just like you'd find on a motorcycle.
With its unique rear suspension that flexes just like a big cat and its 430 horsepower Corvette engine, the Rocket 3 will scram, doing 0 to 60 in less than 4 seconds.
To metal, Randy Grubb's Garage.